Well, hello, I'm Lynn Rustin. I'm the Vice President of the Global Nuclear Policy Program at the Nuclear Threat Initiative, and I'll be moderating our session today. We are really honored to be hosting Dr. Mariana Budjeryn, Senior Research Associate with the Project on Managing the Atom at the Harvard Kennedy School's Belfer Center, and author of the book, Inheriting the Bomb, The Collapse of the USSR and the Nuclear Disarmament of Ukraine. Dr. Budjeryn's timely book offers a comprehensive account of Ukraine's decision-making as a Soviet successor state after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the largest nuclear-armed state. Dr. Budjeryn presents a compelling counter-argument to the prevailing narrative that Ukraine's decision to relinquish its inherited nuclear weapons was naive or regrettable in light of Russia's current horrible aggression. The book sheds light on Ukraine's unique experience at this transformational point in history and offers valuable lessons for our understanding of non-proliferation and disarmament today. At a time when nuclear risks are high and norms are under assault, the book stands as a powerful testament to the critical role of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty in upholding the norm of non-proliferation, and as a reminder that it's a vast misconception to conclude that nuclear weapons are the solution for states whose security is threatened. Dr. Budjeryn will present for 20 or 25 minutes, followed by Q&A. You can submit your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen, and please include your name and affiliation. And just a reminder that today's session is being recorded and it's on the record. So please welcoming me now as I join, join me in welcoming Mariana Budjeryn to speak about her book. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Lynn, and thank you, NTI, for hosting me for this book talk. Let me start sharing my screen to show some slides. One second as I get this sorted out. There we go. So the subtitle of this talk is Ukraine's Nuclear Disarmament and Why It Matters. And I think the second half of this subtitle is in a way the easiest to answer. We have today, we're living and observing, some of us long distance, for some of us it's closer to home, the largest land war in Europe since World War II. There's hundreds of thousands dead and maimed civilians and soldiers on Russian and Ukrainian side. There's millions that have been displaced. There's an entire generation of children growing up in bomb shelters. Concepts or phenomena such as war crimes, you know, genocide, mass killings, mass graves, all of that is back onto our, you know, news feeds and stream and in our consciousness. And of course, in this context, the question of Ukraine's security, but also its nuclear history is back, right? It strides back and it poses some very, very pertinent and difficult questions about whether Ukraine's decision back in the early 1990s to surrender its part of the nuclear arsenal inherited from the Soviet Union was the right decision or was not. And just to preempt this question, I will leave it to the reader of my book to decide for themselves whether we could consider that decision mistaken or how the issue could have been handled otherwise. But suffice it to say that you know, Ukraine did make this decision in 1994. It joined the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons as a non-nuclear weapons state in exchange for a deal that was negotiated. Part of this deal included so-called security assurances by NPT depository states, the United States, the United Kingdom, and the Russian Federation, recorded in the so-called Budapest Memorandum, signed on December 5th, 1994. in which these nuclear states pledged commitments, security commitments, reasserted their commitments to Ukraine, so recognizing Ukraine's international borders, made commitments to abstain from use or threat of force, any force, you know, conventional or nuclear, as well as reasserted their commitment to NPT-related security assurances, not to threaten Ukraine with nuclear weapons, and to bring it, this issue to the UN Security Council should it be threatened thus. Needless to say, in 2014, these commitments came to a test where one of the signatories breached them. Ukraine's peninsula Crimea was occupied and illegally annexed. Russia fueled the war in eastern Ukraine. For Ukrainians, this war started in 2014, right? And since that, and certainly, you know, since this last, the second campaign, the second level of or episode of escalation, I should say, since the full blown and a full scale invasion, there's a narrative that settled, at least in Ukraine's public sphere, that giving up nuclear weapons and this nuclear legacy was a mistake. Look what happens to countries who are not protected by a nuclear deterrent. Right, the optics are really regrettable. And we've seen and heard even the leaders, such as at one point Ukraine's ambassador to Germany, Andriy Melnyk, and even allusions at one point by President Zelensky to say that perhaps Ukraine should reconsider this set of decisions. On the other side of the spectrum, as it were, there's a different narrative, a different interpretation. In the West, this episode of nuclear history has been largely forgotten, it seems. You know, apart from the people who were really deeply involved in this at the time, it's not a widely known fact, right, that Ukraine was one of the nuclear inheritors after the Soviet collapse, or the particulars of the deal that precipitated its disarmament. And beyond the oblivion, there's also the stake that, well, these were not even Ukrainian weapons to give up, that these were Soviet weapons simply left over on Ukraine's territory, that Ukraine did not have command and control over these weapons and could not have used them as a deterrent. My take, as someone who spent an embarrassingly long time researching and writing this book, is that the truth is more nuanced than either one of these and more simplified narratives suggest. The truth is more complicated. There's certainly some validity to both of these narratives, but I hope that reading my book will bring that necessary nuance and inform these discussions and perhaps, you know, these feelings and narratives of regret a little better. So when the Soviet Union collapsed, it is often taken for granted that Russia should have been, of course, the one and only successor of the USSR in most realms, right? And in particular in the nuclear realm. Now, this is only partially true. And I think there have been quite significant blind spots in the Western discourses, because throughout the Cold War, Russia and the USSR have been perennially conflated. Even very well-informed people and you know, experts who should have known better could use these terms interchangeably. Russia, USSR, Soviet Russia, you know, the decades of interaction between Washington and Moscow created these blind spots towards the periphery, towards these outer reaches of the Soviet Empire. And so there was an impression, as it were, that when the Soviet Union did collapse, suddenly the earth opened up and out came, you know, the Kazakhs and the Azeris and the Georgians and Ukrainians. And oh my God, where did these old people come from? And all of them wanted independence and to be recognized and to be treated as sovereign nations. And that took some time. They took some change, at least on the part of Western officials, to kind of get adjusted to this new reality. And this new reality was also very much complicated by the fact that four out of these new successors, the Russian Federation as one of the successors, but also Kazakhstan and Belarus and Ukraine, inherited large chunks of Soviet nuclear arsenal on their left behind by the defunct Soviet Union on their territory, and also parts of the nuclear industrial, military industrial infrastructure that delivered this Soviet deterrent. And this became, bar none, one of the most important foreign policy questions for the US and one of the dominating issues for these new countries to sort out as they were trying to establish themselves on the international arena as these new sovereigns. As you can see here on this map, Ukraine had a quite a generous package, as it were, generous chunk of this very large nuclear arsenal, two nuclear missile divisions at Pervomaysk and Khmelnytsky. Here's the Pervomaysk and Khmelnytsky with a total of 176 ICBMs, two strategic bomber regiments have a total of 44 strategic bombers, Tu-160s and Tu-195 MS Bears. Incidentally, the same aircraft Russia uses today to lob off cruise missiles at Ukraine. You know, a large number of tactical nuclear weapons, nearly 3,000 nuclear weapons, tactical nuclear weapons. There were storage facilities. There was also a military industrial infrastructure, such as the Pivdenna Design Bureau and the Pivdenna Machine Building, a plant also known by the Russian name Yuzhnaya and Yuzhmash, that was one of three main ICBM manufacturers in the Soviet Union. In fact, at the time of Soviet dissolution, it was the main manufacturer of MIRV, the multiple warhead ICBMs. At the time of Soviet dissolution in 1991, about 70% of all strategic nuclear missile-based warheads were deployed on Ukrainian-based missiles, right? So the bulk of Soviet deterrent, as it were, was sitting on these Ukrainian-made delivery vehicles. What Ukraine did lack was the nuclear fuel cycle. It lacked very, very significant parts, again, of something that would have been needed to make up a fully fledged nuclear weapons program. So in that sense, it is correct that there would have needed to be much investment and an effort on Ukrainian part in order to shape this nuclear inheritance into an actual nuclear deterrent that Ukraine could, quote unquote, use. Ukraine did have a lot of scientific and industrial capacity to do that. It was a highly industrialized part of the Soviet Union. And so if there were a will, there would have been a way. But in the end, as Ukraine deliberated its choices, it ended up opting for disarmament. And again, there was a decision to be made there. And there were, here I tried to sort of collect different kind of factors, different things that weighed either in favor of nuclear option or preserving some kind of nuclear option and in favor of disarmament. And as you can see, there were things on both sides of that ledger. Of course, you know, security concerns became rather prominent early on, mostly over Crimea, the division of the Black Sea Fleet, and the general kind of doubt, at least on the part of Ukrainian political elites, that this new Russia, this kind of the Russia that Ukraine hoped would be just a fellow democracy, you know, charting this path toward a democratic and free market transition, that new Russia might be just a bit more of the old imperial kind of formation that would try and reclaim and establish a hegemony in the former Soviet region. There were also Status concerns. Ukraine wanted a recognition and wanted a seat at the table for negotiating these very important issues that concerned assets on its territory. So it was not willing to relinquish, say, things like, the coming into force of a START treaty that was originally a bilateral treaty between the United States and the Soviet Union. It wanted to become a party and a successor state to that treaty and deliberate that in the parliament and have a chance to ratify it, for instance. It also, Ukrainian leaders very quickly realized that, you know, the nuclear issue was very much important for the powerful states, and including the United States. And inadvertently, the singular tension of the American foreign policy establishment, at least under the George H.W. Bush administration, when Secretary Baker was in charge of the State Department, the singular focus on the nuclear issue it served to elevate the value and the worth of these weapons in the eyes of the Ukrainian leaders. So, you know, places like Minsk and Kiev and Almaty that would have not even hit the radar of a lot of U.S. policymakers suddenly became destinations for very high-flying U.S. and international delegations. And the first thing they asked about was the nuclear weapons, right? So this is something for U.S. policymakers to keep in mind for the future. And of course, there was an internal lobby. There was a vested interest, at least in keeping the ICBM, the delivery vehicle part of this deterrent in motion. Otherwise, it looked like a lot of people would have been out of a job. But today in Ukraine, a lot of people forget, the formidable impediments to actually retaining and reshaping this inheritance into something that, again, would be, quote unquote, a usable deterrent, you know, certainly if it was Russia that Ukraine was intending to deter. It is often forgotten that Ukraine started its path towards independent statehood with a unilateral declaration, with a preference to become a nuclear-free state. That was recorded in July 1990 in the Declaration of Ukraine's Sovereignty, a very foundational document that kind of wrested more kind of power and autonomy from the center, from Moscow. And there was an article there that was proposed by Ukrainian National Democrats and in the parliament saying Ukraine wants in the future to become a nuclear-free state. That was a revolutionary proposition because Ukraine was still part of the Soviet Union, still would be part of the Soviet Union for another year and a half at that point. And there was a very formidable nuclear force deployed on Ukraine's territory. So saying you want to be a nuclear-free state, that throws a big wrench into Soviet military planning, right? So it was a strategic decision. But a big part of that decision also, or the part of that declaration, was the experience of Chernobyl and this great social trauma that was inflicted by this worst nuclear accident in history, and more so by the mismanagement, perceived mismanagement, and very real mismanagement of the aftermath by the Soviet authorities. So anti-nuclear in Ukraine at that point became also anti-Moscow, anti-institutional, right? It was seen as a symbol of this kind of oppression and the kind of dysfunction of the system. Say, see what they do to us. They deploy this faulty reactor. They do these tests without following the procedures correctly. And then they neglect the people. They bus their own kids off to, you know, safe places and then make us march in the May 1st parade, right? So there was a lot of that resentment. And that shaped kind of this foundational stance of Ukraine towards things nuclear. As I mentioned, for Ukraine to complete the parts of the missing parts of a nuclear weapons program would have taken quite a bit of investment and effort. And amid a really severe economic crisis that followed the dissolution of the Soviet Union, that would have been a very difficult argument to make to how to divert these very scarce resources from the civilian economy towards something like a nuclear program. Of course, there was a concerted U.S. and Russian political and economic condominium on the issue. The interests of both the states coincided on the fact that there should be only one nuclear successor to the Soviet Union. And when, you know, while of course for Russia it was a matter of status, it was a matter of stature to inherit that part, to have the monopoly on this nuclear inheritance from the Soviet Union. For the US, it was certainly also the concerns about loose nukes and non-proliferation. And I know that the founding fathers of this, of NTI specifically, Senator Nunn has been instrumental in shaping US policies towards the Soviet dissolution. And the Nunn-Lugar Act on Technical Assistance for Disarmament became one of the most innovative foreign policy responses to this unprecedented challenge that actually in the end helped convince Ukrainians that they would have this technical assistance, they would have help in trying to complete the disarmament work, because disarmament costs money just as much as arms building does. One of the things that I found in my research that perhaps goes somewhat underappreciated is a very instrumental and critical indeed role of the international non-proliferation regime, and in particular the NPT, the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, in basically framing and shaping the options available to Ukraine at the time. So there was certainly a matter of US policy and the policies of the powerful states' responses to this predicament. But there was also a broader international consensus that was forged by this history at that point, three decades, right? There was a 25 year review and extension conference coming up in 1995 of this very large and comprehensive non-proliferation regime that Ukraine could not have possibly joined if it wanted to retain or kind of really insist on its claim of being a Soviet successor in the nuclear domain, just like Russia, right? There were only five places for nuclear states, right? And the very purpose and object of that treaty was to limit the spread of nuclear weapons to more states. And even though kind of the collapse of one of the parties was not exactly envisioned by this treaty, right? And Ukrainians quite resented being kind of called proliferators. They did not start or launch any clandestine nuclear weapons programs in violation of any international commitments and norms. They were part and parcel of contributing to this Soviet nuclear program. And the Soviet Union was a recognized nuclear weapons state under the NPT. So they recognized that the treaty did not really accommodate Ukrainian situation very well. And yet it limited the existence of the treaty in this regime, limited options that were available to Ukraine. And very soon Ukrainian leaders realized that if they wanted to make any sort of or retain any kind of hedging or nuclear options, that they would have to stay outside of this regime. And that brought with it certain consequences. And the company at the time, at least outside of the regime, was not particularly savory. You had North Korea, you had, countries that were considered to be in breach of their NPT commitments, Iraq, Iran, Libya. It was not a particularly good company to be found in. And let's remember, this is before India and Pakistan declared their nuclear deterrence in 1998. And so I'd like to just conclude with three brief takeaways from that might be most pertinent for us today. From this Ukraine story. And one of the takeaways that I would like to impress is that the fact that Ukraine made this decision, which was in the end the right decision, under the circumstances and more broadly, right? It was a good decision for Ukraine. It was a good decision for the world. But the fact that Ukraine made that decision does not mean that there was no decision to be made. Ukraine had options and it had agency in this matter. It had, a capacity to build up, at least maintain a hedge should it wanted to. Ukraine also had this very, unprecedented claim that was not that was not crazy, that it was a successor state to a nuclear weapon state, to the USSR. And in fact, in every other domain, for instance, in terms of conventional weaponry, there was no contestation whether the tanks and the artillery pieces and, you know, the conventional aircraft left on Ukraine's territory would be Ukraine's property. And yet, my argument is that the very existence of the NPT made sure that the nuclear part of this Soviet inheritance fell under different set of rules. And these rules frame and guided Ukrainian options, and in the end helped kind of channel them into this direction of renunciation. Another takeaway is that Ukraine did not, again, enter a world that was kind of anarchical and a free-for-all. It had to contend with a world that already had a certain order. The NPT was, as I said, part of this international order, a very important constitutive part of this international order. But also, there is an unsung role for the existing, the arms control architecture that existed at that time. I already mentioned the START Treaty, the Strategic Arms Reductions Treaty. That helped bring a lot of transparency to what was where on this vast Soviet territory. It was luckily that all of these assets, strategic nuclear assets, were declared under this treaty and were to be, you know, reduced. So that brought transparency. The presidential nuclear initiatives that basically helped withdraw tactical nuclear weapons from the territory of the non-Russian republics to the Russian territory, basically ensured that some of the most grabbable and, as it say, usable nuclear assets were out and in central storage facilities in Russia. And there's an unsung role for the INF treaty that banned the ranges for delivery systems from 500 to 5,500 kilometers. Now, when Ukrainians really started considering an option of retaining some kind of even conventionally armed kind of strategic deterrent, they quickly realized that the ranges that they might need or might be useful, again, if it was Russia that they want to deter, were exactly the ranges that were prohibited under the INF. And as a successor of the Soviet Union, Ukraine was properly a party to the INF and therefore subject to its ban. Not to mention that, of course, before the INF missiles were dismantled and destroyed under the INF, the last one in June 1991, Ukraine was chock full of INF assets, the SS-20s and such. And the last takeaway is has to do with the famous, or now infamous, Budapest Memorandum. You know, it's got a lot of bad rap, especially in Ukraine. There's a lot of kind of discussions that this is, you know, a piece of paper, a worthless piece of paper, and it's worth nothing. And I would disagree with that very strongly. International deals are difficult, right? They're difficult to negotiate, they're difficult to agree, and they're difficult to enforce. And I put it on Ukraine that prior to 2014, it did very little to leverage this document, whether it's some kind of leftover Soviet formalism or other form of, you know, maybe just political neglect, I'm not sure, but there seemed to have been a sort of complacency, right? So we got this document signed, you know, three very powerful nuclear countries signed it, and in Ukrainian it said guarantees, not assurances. In Russian too, it said guarantees, not assurances. So Ukrainians kind of shelved it and said, hey, we've got security guarantees. And the thing is, that was, there was a document Ukraine could have leveraged before 2014 in a much more meaningful way as a framework for a deeper defense and military cooperation with the signatories or with the United States and the UK should have chosen to. And post 2014, certainly the other signatories that were in compliance of the documents could have been more generous with their interpretation of the commitments and of the significance of this document. In fact, it was entirely sidelined. There was one meeting of the signatory parties on March 5th, 2014, just as Russia was preparing to conduct the illegal referendum in Crimea. You know, there was a statement that was produced. Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov just, you know, did not show up to a meeting, did not, you know, think it was important, even though he was in Paris where the meeting happened at the time. He just kind of snubbed it. And then there was no, basically very little reference to the Budapest Memorandum. And again, that's regrettable because even that military and defense assistance that was then extended to Ukraine could have been framed in terms of, you know, kind of fulfilling the spirit of this agreement and would have been a boost for the non-proliferation regime, of which I argue the Budapest Memorandum is a constitutive part, right? It was a deal negotiated specifically to accompany Ukraine's decision, Ukraine's act of accession to the NPT. It's attached, it's on the website, on the UN website as a document that kind of accompanied that action. And so with a very brief recap, you know, fast forward to today, certainly with all this nuance and all of the arguments for the right Ukrainian decision and the kind of considered and right Ukrainian decision back at the time, the optics of the situation in Ukraine are really quite regrettable for the non-proliferation regime. On the one hand, that is, of course, because nuclear deterrence seems to be proving its worth. The war in Europe broke out in sort of this vacuum, security vacuum, in a country that did not have a nuclear deterrent, you know, of its own, nor was it covered by extended nuclear deterrence of an ally. And so in a way, it's not surprising that the war should have broken out in that space. And the fears, very justified and considered fears of escalation, are actually restraining this conflict from spilling over. You know, NATO and the Western countries considered the military aid they extend to Ukraine very carefully for its escalatory potential. They said it prior to the invasion, they will not get involved directly. Ukraine has not gone to the UN and invoked Article 51 for collective defense. Why? Because Ukraine knows nobody would actually physically come, right? Again, because two nuclear powers should not, you know, should take great care not to be involved in a direct conventional confrontation for a very justified fear of nuclear escalation. And this, presumably, is one of the ways in which nuclear deterrence works. And on the other hand, you know, there is a direct impact on the credibility of the non-proliferation regime since, you know, Ukraine did make this commitment, did make this decision to disarm in exchange, right, for these security assurances that are now violated. There is also a diminished prospect of arms control per Article 6 of the NPT because of the war and because the two sides, you know, the United States and Russia, who together hold 90% of nuclear weapons, are really not on speaking terms. So very difficult to see how any progress on arms control could be made. In fact, Russia just suspended its participation in the last standing nuclear arms control agreement. And so the jury's still out. I think, you know, it remains to be seen how this war is fought and ends and what role nuclear weapons will play in it. There's a non-negligible risk of the actual use of Russia's use of nuclear weapons in this war. And it might be that with, you know, grit and perseverance and Western military assistance, Ukraine will prevail in some sense, right? In some shape or form. And then the story could be, see, it's better to have friends than nuclear weapons. See, it's even a smaller country, non-nuclear armed country, can stand up to a nuclear bully. And, you know, with this kind of solidarity and international support, it can prevail. But I think that there will also be very small comfort for people who have lost their loved ones in this war. You know, with tens of thousands dead and a generation of children who cannot be unscarred, you can bring these people to life. You know, thousands of women cannot be unraped, and all the damage cannot be undone. These experiences cannot be unlived. And so my job as somebody who has spent her career trying to try and see for the ways of diminishing the role of nuclear weapons in the world and in security, my job has getting a lot harder to try and convince people in Ukraine and perhaps people in a similar security predicament like Ukraine, that the answer to the question, how could this have been prevented in the first place? That the answer is not nuclear weapons. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mariana. That was such a rich talk, and there are a lot of really interesting threads to pull on, which we will do in the Q&A. I think all of us feel that our work has gotten, yes, much harder, but also all the more important. And that's a good segue to the fact that we are lucky to be joined today by former Senator Sam Nunn, co-chair of and founder of NTI. I read with interest that your footnotes included some of his trip reports from his congressional trips to the region, to Ukraine and Russia in this time period, and also talks about the important role of the Nunn-Lugar program, as you just spoke about briefly. And I see Senator Nunn now, we'll all be so interested, Senator, to hear any comments you have, as well as any questions for Dr. Budjeryn.
Mariana, that's a terrific, terrific presentation, and I look forward to reading your book. I think you've come closer to a 360 degree perspective of various pitfalls of the road taken, but also the various pitfalls of perhaps the road not taken, being to keep the nuclear weapons. This is a remarkable analysis, and I agree with almost all of it. I would say that the jury, as you have said, is still out. I would think the jury is still out on whether nuclear deterrence worked in this case, because there's more than one form of nuclear deterrence. President Putin basically made every effort to deter United States and the European countries, as well as the NATO countries, including NATO countries, intervening with military supplies and equipment and assistance for Ukraine. And those threats, and he made numerous threats to basically threaten the use of nuclear weapons to anyone who interfered, I'm not trying to quote him directly, they've pretty much been ignored by the tremendous support that has been poured into Ukraine in terms of weapons and supplies and humanitarian, as well as, of course, the tremendous political support around the world and condemnation of this this invasion by Russia. And of course, what you've already observed is Russia's breach of the Budapest Agreement, flagrant breach, has made the whole regime of nonproliferation much more difficult. And I think you're dead correctly on that. And, you know, all of these things still have to play out, but I think your report is extremely, extremely valuable. I had two questions. One is, did you get into the question of whether Ukraine ever had operational control? You alluded to that. They certainly had physical possession, but Senator Lugar and I were in both Russia as well as Ukraine and Kazakhstan and Belarus during the early 90s timeframe, and met with your leaders in Ukraine, President Kravchuk, and a number of members of parliament who were very much opposed to Ukraine giving up nuclear weapons. And my impression back in that period of time from those discussions on both with Russia and Ukraine was that Ukraine had physical control, but not operational control. At one point, there was an announcement, or at least a news article that said the Ukrainians were seeking operational control. That was before the decision had been made to denuclearize, and that set off all sorts of alarm bells, both in Europe and in Russia and the United States. So I guess my question is, did you get into the question of whether there was operational control? Of course, there were a huge number of warheads on the Ukrainian soil, huge number of missiles, and Ukraine had played a huge part in the Soviet Union procurement of those weapons. And so they certainly had the knowledge and know-how and could have used the nuclear material one way or the other, but it would have been time consuming if they had not had operational control. So question, operational control, did you make any conclusion on that? Second question, if the Ukraine had taken the other road, i.e. if it had kept its nuclear weapons, do you have any kind of conclusions about the effect of that on Kazakhstan and Belarus, both of whom gave up all of their nuclear weapons on their soil? So those are the two questions. But thank you very much. This is an extremely valuable contribution.
Thank you, Senator Nan. You're very kind. And of course, thank you for being part of this really timely and extremely innovative set of responses to the Soviet collapse. I think we're all the better and the safer for it. So about operational control, Ukrainians did not in the end have operational control throughout the whole story. In mid-1993, there have been reported attempts under the guise of Ukrainians trying to establish the negative control, right, to prevent the launch from the Ukrainian territory. That has been a demand that President Kravchuk has voiced, since the early days, since about mid-1992. And it seems that the good people in Kharkiv, which was one of the big nodes of Soviet defense production, particularly Khartron, that did targeting and guidance systems for the SS-19 missiles that were also deployed in Ukraine, but the SS-24s were produced in Ukraine, but the guidance systems produced elsewhere. Anyways, that there was an effort by the scientists and engineers to interfere with the centralized Moscow-run system of command and control. From the people I talked to, it seems that it was really quite feasible to cut off the control at the level of the army, because the way the kind of these five links in Soviet command control of strategic missiles, that it wasn't a risk-free enterprise, but it was technically feasible. I think the reasoning there was it would have been certainly very visible to Russia, right, and to probably US intelligence agencies as well. So if you were going to go for it, there would have needed to be a bigger plan, right? And the bigger plan would have had to include, well, what do you do with the warheads? How do you maintain them? Do you start facilities on your own territory for dismantling them to preserve the nuclear material and to maybe kind of reuse it later on? So really that again went up against the discussions, well, long-term, right? We can do it now, we can grab the assets, but what will it give us? Except the really adverse reaction from Russia and the international community. And I think that when that brought a whole range of broader discussions of whether Ukraine was in any shape or form in state to launch or at least maintain some kind of an option for a fully fledged nuclear program. And the answer was no. There were feasibility studies for a centrifuge facility, for an enrichment facility that I came across. Of course, that would have been conducted under the guise of the civilian nuclear program, for which, again, very justifiable kind of set of reasons, because Ukraine is a heavily nuclearized country with 50% of its energy mix coming from nuclear power plants. So there were these considerations, but in the end, I think the deal struck on the highly enriched uranium swap, the megatons to megawatts, and part of the compensation that came to Ukraine for the fissile material in the form of fuel assemblies for the nuclear power plants that was also facilitated by the United States. That kind of, again, helped to sway Ukrainian decision-making towards, you know, not pursuing enrichment, not starting these facilities, but going toward, you know, kind of an easier and quicker option. About your second question about Belarus and Kazakhstan, I think Kazakhstan in particular was paying very close attention to Ukrainian negotiations, mostly because they wanted to get at least as much as Ukraine had negotiated for itself. But I think the options those two were considering, would have considered, certainly Kazakhstan considered at the time, is to retain these missiles under Russian control, very much like maybe, you know, because at that time, Kazakhstan and eventually Belarus became part of the Tashkent, what then later became Collective Security Treaty Organization, you know, like a military alliance. So Kazakhstan's argument was, well, you know, US has nuclear weapons deployed to countries in Europe. You know, this could be a similar situation where these weapons stay on the Kazakh territory, but under the Soviet control. I mean, sorry, the Russian control. And again, that was a position in Washington at the time to push back at that and to, you know, they didn't know which way things would go. It was a very fluid situation, as you probably well remember. And this decision was, if there is a way to denuclearize a country altogether, then we'll take it. And in the end, that was the path taken.
Thank you, Senator, for joining us and providing your insights and questions. And thanks, Mariana, for your responses. So I'm going to go now to the audience questions because the time is going by very quickly. And we have a question kind of picking up on the thread you were just on about Kazakhstan and Belarus and how they responded somewhat differently. Kyle Tucker, who is at Indiana University and a Scoville Fellow, has asked whether any figures in Kazakhstan or Belarus have since expressed regret at giving up nuclear weapons. And of course, I'll add my own comment that we now have the situation where President Putin has announced his intention to, and Lukashenko in Belarus has agreed, I gather, to you know, host nuclear weapons on their territory. So anything on that, you know, set of how the different successor states reacted to their inheritance.
Thank you so much to Kyle. Hi out there. He's I'm very happy to know that he's attending. Kazakhstan. I'm not aware about any particular regrets in Kazakhstan about that. In fact, quite the opposite. I think it was a very prudent policy of Kazakhstan to really capitalize on its decision to disarm and on its non-proliferation credentials. Kazakhstan became a very vocal and very active participant in the non-proliferation regime. You know, the establishment of the nuclear Central Asian weapons of mass destruction free zone and so forth. So that was, you know, cooperating with the United States and the IAEA and the LEU Bank and all of these, you know, very important initiatives. In Belarus, with the coming of Alexander Lukashenko to power, there immediately sort of this whole problem, this whole process of disarmament became hostage, as it were. So of course the custody was Russian and there was no dispute about that, but it seemed that he wanted kind of more commitment from Russia at the time. So there was an episode of him trying to stop the removal of the SS-25s. They were mobile systems. So, you know, in the sense they were kind of more grabbable, as it were. But, you know, there was no attempts to sort of establish independent Belarusian control over them. But there was an attempt to kind of keep the Russian military entanglement or military commitment continued on the Russian territory. And as far as I remember, under the on the CTR program, the cooperation was terminated before all of the launch pads, all of the infrastructure for the SS-25, for these kind of very heavy machines, were dismantled under the program. Again, you know, whether those could be reused now, whether that's something Iskander's could use as is a I'm uncertain, but certainly, you know, someone like Lukashenko was not beyond using these kind of nuclear nuclear elements, as it were, for his negotiations with Moscow, and again to negotiate a greater commitment from the Russian side.
Right. Thank you. Okay, well, shifting gears a little, we have a question from Dr. Siegfried Hecker, who notes that you stated that Ukraine at the time entered a world that had nuclear order, including all the treaties that you talked about, primarily and first and foremost, the NPT. But Sig notes that on February of 2022, Russia essentially destroyed that nuclear order through its, you know, subsequent threats and saber rattling and attacks on the Zaporizhia and all. So Sig's question is, you know, how does that affect Ukraine's decisions going forward?
Right. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Hecker, for the question. You know, I don't think the nuclear order is destroyed per se. I would disagree with that. It's, you know, the international nuclear order or global nuclear order is a perpetual system in distress, right? It has already built in fissures and tensions and things. And of course, the war in Ukraine has exacerbated them, perhaps critically, but the regime has survived shocks in the past, right? So hopefully, fingers crossed, it might last. But it certainly is not particularly good news for the NPT and for its credibility when one of the major stakeholders in that order is also the party that brazenly violates it. For Ukraine today, I think many of the same limiting factors, many of the same inhibitions would exist that would push against, you know, a way against a nuclear option. I think just being part of, you know, the proverbial West and having that kind of support, international solidarity and support behind it is essential, and that Ukraine would not risk that in any sense for, you know, the kind of the uncertain nuclear option that might or might not come to fruition after, you know, decades, but probably that would need to be put into it. And that's, hopefully, that's the lesson that we can impart in the story, the collective we, is that it's better to have allies and friends than nuclear weapons, right? And I'm hoping that that's the kind of unwavering and strong support for Ukraine would continue, not least to enforce this message.
Thank you. Well, kind of, I mean, in a way you already answered this, but there is a question from Bob Einhorn, who at the Brookings Institution and former Assistant Secretary of State for Nonproliferation. And he actually asked whether there's any serious debate in Ukraine about pursuing an indigenous weapons capability. And I guess I would add to that a question about the missiles, because as you know, Ukraine is the only successor state that really has the substantial capacity to build strategic and intermediate range ballistic missiles, because that's what it did for the Soviet Union. And of course, now that the INF Treaty is, it was a successor state to the INF Treaty. And frankly, that I always had that in mind in this question about what the United States should do about the Russian violation, because there are more than two parties to that treaty. So is there any chance that, or debate about Ukraine's desire to have an indigenous capability for conventionally armed intermediate range ballistic missiles?
So if there is a serious debate in Ukraine, I don't know about it, but certainly not about the nuclear issue. I think the allusions to this nuclear option, especially before the war, and in particular, President Zelensky said something, the Munich Security Conference on February 19th, right before the invasion. I think those tend to backfire because then, you know, President Putin turned that around, said, oh, look, Ukraine has nuclear ambitions, and another casus belli, if he needed another one, right? So those tend to backfire if, you know, if there are any serious considerations that they might be so secret that none of us would know it. But I seriously doubt that for the reasons that I enumerated. On the conventional missile capability, I think that was a big miss on the Ukrainian part. And for the 30 years that it had, you know, it could have developed missile systems, you know, under 500 kilometers. And apparently there, which would have come useful in this war, right? I think the Ukraine's sort of missed opportunity was not so much, you know, retaining a nuclear option as neglecting its conventional capability in the meantime, with all the, again, legacy capability, you know, industrial capacity that it had. And there are, there were projects developed, Sapsan, sort of short-range ballistic missile program or system developed by Pivdenna for the Saudis. That would have been just under INF 480 kilometer ranges. That was never put into serial production and so forth. So it is kind of on Ukrainians in a way now that they're walking around begging for these longer range fires where they actually had the capacity to develop them indigenously. I think that we will see logically a rise of another missile power in Europe, and that will be Ukraine. I think those capacities will be mobilized now.
Interesting. Thank you. So we're just about out of time. I'm going to kind of combine a question that I have with one from the audience and have you answer them together. They're related. We have an observation and a question from Thomas Neff, who was involved in the original HEU deal and kind of asked about whether U.S. attention to Ukraine and focus on the nuclear issues actually resulted in a delay of the removal of warheads. And his perspective is that Ukraine's to some extent played the U.S. Let me just zoom back, because my question for you was broader, which was related, which is how you overall assess the diplomatic skill and creativity of President Bush and his team, National Security Advisor Brent Scowcroft and Secretary of State Jim Baker. Of course, I'm talking about Bush 41, not 43, because it seems to me they did some really bold and visionary things, including the presidential nuclear initiatives that you referenced to unilaterally withdraw a large number of U.S. tactical nuclear weapons around the world, partly as an example and to encourage parallel actions from the Soviet Union and its for the former states. And yet you suggested, and this is what Thomas is referring to here, that the U.S. may have overemphasized its concern about nuclear weapons in its diplomacy with those states, and thus sort of inadvertently enhanced the prestige and value of those weapons. So I'm curious how you overall assess the Bush, George H.W. Bush's administration's nuclear diplomacy and what was an unprecedented and really dangerous and transformational point in history.
I mean, indeed, it was an unprecedented kind of development. And my reading is that, you know, there's always kind of this toss off between freedom and stability, right? Both are values and both have their appeal. And, you know, by about still mid-1991, the Bush administration was firmly on the side of stability. If we remember the famous, infamous Chicken Kiev speech, right? Suicidal nationalism and freedom is not the same as independence. That was very much interpreted by Ukrainians as, you know, kind of a stab in the back that they were, you know, fighting the evil empire. We're supposed to be on the one side of the barricades. And but having said that, you know, when kind of history overtook the best of the plans of the administration, the set of responses was really incredibly innovative. I mean, the PNIs and also they, you know, being familiar with a little bit of the backstory on the non-Luger cooperative threat reduction, just to imagine convincing the Congress to appropriate US taxpayer dollars to channel it toward your former adversary to help them, you know, deal with the mess that they themselves have created. You know, let's be honest, they had money to build up weapons. Now we're paying for them to dismantle that. That's a really tall order. So I think the set of kind of conceptually, the set of responses and the swiftness with which they were sort of pushed through and implemented is really an innovative and astounding. It is true that there was kind of a singular, at least under Bush senior administration, singular focus on the nuclear issue. And let's remember that was towards the end of the, Bush was going into election year and kind of there was a little policy drift or momentum that was set there. And the Clinton administration actually diversified that policy. So the pressure remained, right? The focus on nuclear weapons and nuclear disarmament remained, but it got augmented by also some positive incentives. And that really helped, right? The Ukrainians felt heard. That's something that, you know, because there they are, 1993, it's 10,000% inflation in the country. I was a student then in Kyiv. I remember it very, very well. Like your money devalued literally day from day to day. And the US delegations that roll in, they're like, yeah, great. You know, guys, we'll help you sort out the economic thing later. But first, what are you gonna do with nuclear weapons? So I think balancing that under the Clinton administration after the foreign policy review was really did bear out results.
Well, thank you so much. It's so interesting. I think there are a lot of people I think on this call, who are involved in different pieces of this. But I learned a lot from reading your book and learned things I didn't know and was reminded of things I'd forgotten. It's really a wonderfully researched book. I recommend it to everyone. I thank you so much for joining us today. I thank the audience for participating. I thank Senator Nunn. We'll have to do a whole other webinar for people to answer Mariana's question right now about what was it like to convince the Congress to do that. But we are out of time today, so I thank you, and I thank the NTI team who helped us put this together today, and our conversation and our work to reduce nuclear risks continues.